Bole Baba Ki Jai.
So here we are at the completion of our beautiful Navratri morning. It's actually afternoon now. And we're going to do a few bhajans. And since today is Hanuman Day, we will start with the Hanuman Chalisa. I think Prem and I will dispense with our mass so that we can actually sing and breathe at the same time. It's a little bit challenging. So first do the Hanuman Chalisa. We'll sing a couple of bhajans and then we'll do a discourse. One of my favorites. Remember the first time I did Navratri and Harikon, the first day, I wasn't sure if I was going to ever walk again after sitting for so many hours for pujas and fire ceremonies and artis and discourses, and that's just how it is for Navratri. It's a time we really submerge ourselves in the Divine Mother, but it's not always something our bodies are totally used to. Thank you. karma. Somebody see the number for daya karma?
Eight.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Shveshvari Mata Ki Jai. One more? Or should we go on with the discourse? What would you like?
I'm voting for the discourse.
Discourse, okay. We have a vote for the discourse, so we'll leave Abba Kite. We'll sing some more tomorrow. It is a long morning. Supreme devotion and faith in the Divine Mother story. It's absolutely one of my favorite stories. Okay. Whether we'll get to the whole thing today or not, let's see. If not, there's always tomorrow. If you need to get a chair, you certainly can.
Okay.
That translation is a really good translation. So,
it's a condensation of the whole Srimad Devi Bhagavatam. And if anybody needs a cup of chai, it's in the door in the living room. But if you can hear the story, you should probably hear it, the whole thing. Baba Ki Jai. Good idea. Get a chair if you need. So, I remember King Janamajaya is having this whole Srimad Devi Bhagavatam narrated to him in the hopes that he will be enlightened. So Vedavyasa is telling him all of this. So King Janamajaya asks, Immaculate Vedavyasa, tell me more about the Blessed Divine Mother and tell me more stories from this blessed Srimad Devi Purana. I feel wondrous peace steal over my spirit as I listen to you. Vedavyasa said, Once in Kosala, in the city of Ayodhya, there ruled a noble king. His name was Dhruvasandhi. Dhruvasandhi was a king of Dharma, and Kosala flourished during his reign. The king had two beautiful young wives, Manorama and Lila Bhakti, who were the delight of his days and nights. In due course, they both became pregnant. Manorama gave birth first to a fine prince, and he was named Sudarshana. A month later, Lilavata delivered a radiant child, and they called him Shatrajita. As the two children grew, it turned out that Shatrajita was by far the handsomer of the two, and he was the one with the gifted tongue. Soon there was no doubt which of these were the favorite of the people, the ministers, and even the king themselves. The king was a keen hunter, and one day in the jungle he went out with his party and wounded a lion with their arrows. Roaring, the beast escaped. Though this is very dangerous, the king ordered his warriors to go after him, and he led the party. And suddenly, in a small clearing, the lion jumped out on the king and killed him. So word flew back to the palace in Ayodhya, and the city was plunged in mourning that their king had been killed. Vashista, who is the Kalguru, the guru of the royal family, arrived in the palace in the Vana where he was hunting and performed the last rites for the wonderful king, Dhruvasandhi. His body was cremated in the jungle's heart as though on a field of war where he had fought his final battle. Though Kshatrijita was a great favorite with the people and even with the king's ministers, there was no question that the older prince, the quieter Sudarshana, would now be the king. Being just 5 years old, the princes were not of age yet, but the kingdom must have a sovereign, at least in name. Vasishtha said that the coronation should be not delayed because the people were anxious for this future. However, there arrived in the noble city King Yudhishthira, the grandfather of Kshatrijita, who was just 1 month, remember, just 1 month younger than the less charming Sudarshana, and was far better suited by both gifts and temperament, perhaps, to be the king. Meanwhile, Sudarshana's grandfather, the father of Manorama, arrived also because they knew there was going to be a huge disagreement. Arrived in Ayodhya as well, and he, of course, was adamant that Sudarshana be made the king. An acrimonious debate ensued in the royal sabha of the city. Both Yudhishthira and Visarena had brought their armies with them just in case it didn't go well. Well, indeed, it didn't go well. The grandfather Yudhishthira of Kshatrijita insisted that even though his grandson was 1 month younger, he was by far the most charismatic and should be made the king. Meanwhile, the grandfather of Sudarshana, his name is Virasena, he hollered that no, because he's the eldest, he should be the king. So it broke out into a huge war between the two armies, and the dust of that battle rose in clouds and covered the sun's face so that night seemed to have set in between times, and the blood flowed everywhere. The battle lasted until Yudhishthira cut Virasena's head from his neck in a scarlet fountain. The legions of Virasena fled screaming. Manorama, the daughter of Virasena, heard the news and was terrified. She was certain that Yudhishthira, the grandfather of Kshatrijita, would kill her and her son Sudarshana as well. Desperately, she called her husband's loyal minister, Vidala, who was the most intelligent man in the kingdom. The queen said, "My husband is yet dead. Yudhishthira has killed my father. My son is still a child, and I have no one to turn to. When Yudhishthira rides into Ayodhya again, both my son and I will be at his mercy. His daughter, Lilavati, has always been envious of me because I am the first queen. Tell me that. What shall I do, Vidala, and quickly?" It seemed Vidala had already thought of every eventuality. He didn't hesitate a moment before he said, "You must not stay here, and neither must I. We must flee before Yudhishthira returns. I have an uncle, Subahu, who lives in the forest around Varanasi. He has an army and will protect us." On the pretext of seeing Yudhishthira outside the city gates, Manorama came out of Ayodhya in a chariot with Sudarshana, a maid, and Vidala. Yudhishthira allowed her to perform the last rites for Virasena, and then at twilight, she said she would return to Ayodhya. In fact, she slipped away and rode hard for 2 days and nights and reached the banks of the Ganges. But it seemed that her time of misfortune was still upon her. Manorama, Hersaki, Vidala, and young Sudarshana were waylaid by some bandits who took all their jewels and gold and even their chariot and horses. Her whole world destroyed in a few days. The queen crossed the Ganges by raft at night. Vidala feared for her life if they remained on that side of the river. After another day's hard journey, they arrived ragged at Bharadvaja's, a muni's ashram in Chitrakuta. Little Sudarshana, grave and clinging to his mother's hand, The Muni saw the beautiful young queen and said to her in some amazement, Devi, why are you here in the jungle and your young son with you? Now all her grief burst from her. She began to sob uncontrollably and could not answer the august Muni. Bharadvaja turned to Vidala, who said quietly, My lord, this is Manorama, who is the king Drupasandhi's of Kosala's first queen. Vidala told the Rishi all that had happened in Ayodhya after the king's death. Because the man spoke the truth, the Muni said, Stay with us in our ashram. You have nothing to fear here, and I promise that one day your son, Sudarshana, shall be king of Ayodhya. And so the Muni gave Manorama and Sudarshana a kutir to live in, and they remained there in peace with the queen Shaki, her servant. Vidala also stayed in the ashram, for he could not go back to Ayodhya. Meanwhile, Yudhishthira went back into Ayodhya in triumph, and he asked for Manorama and Sudarshana. He thought they were deceived by his allowing them to cremate Virasena on the battlefield, and now he intended to put both of them to the sword. But the queen and her son had fled. Kosala must have a king, so on an auspicious day, Yudhishthira had his grandson, Satrajita, crowned in Ayodhya. Vasishtha was the chief priest, and all the Munis and ministers chanted the proper Vedas. Yet there were those in Ayodhya who were not carried away by the festivities. Such quiet men remembered Manorama and Sudarshana and agonized about where they were. When Yudhishthira had made certain the throne of Ayodhya was secure to his grandson, he went home to his kingdom, Ujjayina. But it was not long before Yudhishthira heard that Manorama and her son were in Muni Bharadvaja's ashram in Chitrakuta. He gathered an army and set up for the Ganges and that mountain beyond. On Chitrakuta, Manorama heard that Yudhishthira was coming, and she went in tears to the Muni and said, What will I do? Yudhishthira means to come here and kill my child, so his grandson is secure on the throne of Ayodhya. Save me, Holy One. My life and my son are in your hands. When Yudhishthira arrived in the ashram, Muni met him and said, Manorama and her son are in my care. You cannot see them. Yudhishthira replied, I will not leave without taking them with me. You are a man of peace, Muni. Give them to me peacefully, or I will take them by force. The Muni's eyes glittered. He said in a soft voice, You know what happened to Kosika when he tried to take Vasishtha's cow from the Rishi's ashram with force? I beg you, leave us before I grow angry. The king called his ministers aside and said, I mustn't leave Manorama and Sudarshana alive. Even the weakest enemy can grow strong in time and become a threat. I have to kill them. If I spare them one day, they will surely come for my head and my grandson's head. I must take those two from here and kill them. There are no soldiers in this old hermit's ashram to prevent me. But his minister said to him in alarm, My lord, never be so rash. The Muni, Bharadvaja, needs no soldiers to fight us. He can reduce our army to ashes with a look from his eyes. If the Muni protects Manorama and her son, we can do them no harm. Moreover, my lord, Manorama has no wealth of any kind. Her son can never be a threat to us. All the world spins round on the wheel of fate. Be merciful today and ask for the Muni's blessings, and let us leave here in peace. Yudhishthira struggled a moment with his kshatra nature, then fell at the Muni's feet and asked his pardon and blessing, which that kindly Rishi granted. Manorama wept in relief, and she also prostrated herself before the Muni in gratitude. Sudarshana grew in that sanctuary like the moon waxing. His inseparable companions were the Rishi sons, and it was a joy to see those children at play together. Once the Muni's son saw Vidala in the ashram while they were at a game with Sudarshana and called them out playfully to the minister, Kleeb. Sudarshana, who was a little way off, repeated what they said, but leaving out the last consonant. Klee, he said in his lisping voice, and felt the most delicious stirring in his body. Again and again, the child repeated that syllable, never knowing it was the Mula Mantra of Kamadeva, who is the god of love. Each time he felt a soft ecstasy within his body. So without being initiated by any guru other than destiny, the little prince Sudarshana acquired a mystic mantra. He would repeat it in his mind whenever he was alone and just before he fell asleep. And that mantra transformed his very nature. Day by day, he grew more and more brilliant. When Sudarshana was 11, the Rishi began to teach him the Vedas. They were astonished at how quickly he mastered all the sastras. No one knew about the secret power he had gained from repeating the Kamadeva Mula Mantra. The once reticent prince became a magnificent archer, scholar. He knew all he needed to know about politics and the mortal sciences. He brimmed with a quiet assurance. Then one day, while young Sudarshana sat chanting his mantra, the Divine Mother appeared before him in a vision. Ah, she was crimson-hued like a kamsuki flower. She wore a scarlet raiment and her blood-red rubies. He saw her as Devi Sri Lakshmi. The Devi called Sudarshana softly to follow her through the forest to the banks of the Ganges. The prince went without an instant's hesitation, and after he had bathed in the great river, the Devi gave him a splendid bow, two magic quivers of arrows, and an unearthly coat of mail. Then she raised her hand over him in benediction and vanished. After that, Sudarshana became a fierce Devi Bhakti and worshipped the goddess whenever he could, often wandering down to the banks of the Ganges where she had called him. Now it happened that the king of Kasi had a lovely daughter named Sashikala. One day, the princess sat with her Shakti, her servant, under a flowering champaka tree in the garden when she saw a brahmana hurrying along into her father's palace. Sashikala stopped the man for fun and cried, "Whither from which you hastily come, Muni?" "Why, from the Muni Bharadvaja's ashram, princess," replied the cheerful mendicant. Playfully, Shashikali asked, "Tell me of an exceptional thing in this ashram. Muni, the most beautiful thing of all." Without hesitation, the Muni said, "Why, the Princess Sudarshana, princess. Ah, he is handsome past describing, the son of the king, Drupasandi of Ayodhya. I would even say," the Brahmin went on breathlessly, "that if you haven't seen our prince, your eyes have been given you in vain. And besides, he is a great archer and a deep scholar too. Well, let me put it this way, lovely Sashikali. Our Sudarshana is fit to be your husband." And smiling broadly, the Muni breezed away on his errand, leaving Sashikali flushed, a little short of breath, her heart beating faster than ever before in her life. The Rishi's description captured the princess's imagination, and she fell in love with Sudarshana without ever having seen him. One night, perhaps a month later, she first heard of the prince. One month after she heard of the prince in the jungle, Sashikali dreamt of the Divine Mother. The goddess appeared brilliantly in her dream and said, "Child, the prince in the forest is my bhakta. Ask me for a boon and he shall be yours." Sashikala felt she was drowning in a sea of rapture. The next morning, she was so radiant that her mother, the queen, began to press her to divulge the cause of her joy. But Sashikali was bashful and would say nothing, only to her Saki, the one who had been with her when she first heard of Sudarshana, did she confess the truth, giggling and blushing wildly all the while. Then suddenly the princess had tears in her eyes as she whispered, "Ah, Shaki, what shall I do now? I've never seen the prince, yet I'm in love with him. I see him in my dreams, and he is as handsome as Kama Devi." I think, okay, we'll go on a little bit more. But we are gonna have to split this in half. It's a very long story, but it gets better. I can never be happy until I have this Prince Sudarshan as my husband. Vasaki laughed. "Such wild daydreams you must be having, princess. What is gained easily is seldom worthwhile, and hardly lasts a brief season," said her servant, who appeared to know about these things. So Prince Sudarshana, who had lost his kingdom when he was barely 5 years old, who had grown up on wild roots, fruits, and berries in a rishi's ashram in the heart of the forest, with no wealth or army and no power, found a kingdom to rule over, which he never dreamt of, never knowing he had become the king of a beautiful princess's heart. Jai Mahamaya Ki Jai.
Jai.
So, I know you probably won't sleep a moment tonight. Wondering what's going to on, but tomorrow we'll complete it.
That's a happy ending so far.
So
yeah.
The whole ending is happy, but it goes through quite a story.
Okay.
And it's really so, so inspiring to hear the love and the faith that this young prince has in the Divine Mother.
Okay.
So. Much thank you all for joining us today. And tomorrow at 9 a.m., we'll have our Devi Puja. And then at 11, we'll have the fire ceremony again, perhaps outdoors if the snow stops. And then we'll finish the story with some chanting after that. Bole Baba Ki Jai.